Alright, this is the project that we'll be doing on this DVD. It is pears on a plaque. Comes with these feet to stand it up. You can paint both sides. I've prepped this side. I don't know what I'm going to paint on it yet, but I love plaques like this that I can paint both sides and just change out my artwork in my home. So it just makes it so much easier than putting nail holes in your wall. So I really enjoyed doing this project. It was a lot of fun. So let's get started. Okay, I've got this base coated with gray sky, and I've measured in 3/4 of an inch all the way around and marked it off with my compass. I taped off the straight edges with Scotch tape and the curved edge with this green stretchy tape. And you just pull it and press it as you go around to curve things and just make sure you don't have any, you know, bubbles in it. Smooth it down really good. Now I've got this ink pad. It's one that you can find in pretty much any scrapbooking supply place. And we want to color the outside edge and the feet graphite. So I dampened my ink pad in water first, because you don't have to do that. I just like to do it because I think that it helps the paint come out a little bit easier. And you're just going to go all the way around the whole thing. 2 coats. And let it dry. You can do your edges so that your edges match. If you're afraid of paint getting on the back side and bleeding around, or you laying it in some paint accidentally, cover the back with Glad Press and Seal, and then lay it on a cutting mat with the razor blade cut as close as you can to the piece, and then you won't have to worry about anything getting on the back. That's what I usually do with my pieces that are two-sided, where I know I could paint something on the other side, which I normally paint both sides of mine. I rarely leave one side unpainted. It just seems like a waste of a surface, because I can just flip it over and have something completely new sitting out on my fireplace mantle or wherever it is that I want to put it. So I'm going to get 2 coats on this, and then we're going to come back. I'm going to show you how clean of an edge that Scotch tape leaves. Okay, I've got my base coats around my edge and on one side of my feet. I've still got the other side to do. And when you do inside these little places here, just use a small round brush and get in there. You don't want to build it up too much, because you want to make sure that the feet still slide nicely into the plaque itself. Now, I decided I didn't want to leave this just plain gray, and I wanted to mention that you can brush on the paint. You don't have to use the inking dauber thing. I wanted that little bit of texture on there, so I don't want to leave it just this graphite color. So I'm going to use this stencil right here. This is Americana's stick-on stencils. These are made to put on like glass surfaces and terracotta pots and things like that, as you can see up here. I like them because they're already sticky on the back, but plus they have small ones and, you know, bigger ones depending on your size. And so I want to use this particular one right here. I could also use this one and you know, put that kind of border around it. But I think I want to use this and do it randomly on there. So I'm just going to take that one off. So right here. Okay, so I'm just going to stick it randomly, turning it different directions, this way and that way, and create a nice little pattern around the outer edge. And I'm going to use this fingertip dauber this time, because I want to make sure that I don't get too much paint and, you know, have bleed under and stuff. It shouldn't bleed under because it is adhesive, but it could. If you get way too much paint that you're using, then it can bleed under. And you don't have to get full, complete coverage of your stencil. It can look faded out and, you know, irregular. So that's what we want to kind of go for. So I'm just going to start putting some on here. You could also, if you wanted this to be a little bit darker instead of a lighter gray that I'm using, you could go with a black. Ooh. You see how that's just a soft little... So I'm just going to do this, make sure I got it stuck down, randomly, turning it this way and that, all the way around this outer edge. Some of it will be bright, some of it won't. I think I have it. No, that's the sticky side. For a minute I had it on upside down. It's not sticking as well as some of the other ones are. So I'm a little... But I do have some tack it over and over, so if I need to, I can add that to it on the back of it. So you don't have to stencil around the edge. That's totally up to you. But I think it's going to give it just that little touch more of a finished look. Okay, I'm starting to remove the tape here, and I'm pulling slowly just to make sure. Now on this green tape, I see I got out of line past the tape, but that's okay. I can go back and touch it up. This is not a problem. I just want you to see how clean of an edge that you get with Scotch tape. I mean, you just can't get a cleaner edge than that. It's the most amazing thing for us painters ever. Green tape first, because it was the last thing I put on, so it's on top of all of my Scotch tape here. Okay, so I see I'm going to have to go in with my gray sky and do a little bit of touching up and cleaning up, especially on those curves, but that's not a problem. But I think that the stenciling on that just really set that outer edge beautifully. I think it looks wonderful. Now, it's your choice. If you want to do this stenciling on the feet, you can, since it's an extension of this frame. But since I don't know what I'm going to be putting on the other side, I decided to just leave them plain so that whatever I put on the other side doesn't have to also have this stencil on it somewhere. So I'm going to get my touching up done and get my pattern transferred on so we can move on. Okay, as I'm getting ready to put my pattern on, I noticed when I drew it on my tracing paper, because I just created my design right on my tracing paper, that I didn't get it quite centered. So I'm adjusting as I put my pattern down, and I cut a little hole in it, and I'm going to put a piece of tape right in there. I'm going to come over here and cut a little hole over here as well. Pattern will be correct, so you won't have to worry about making adjustments. So now I can just slide my tracing paper. Now I'll need the dark, because this is a lighter background. I'm going to use a gray graphite now. I'm going to try this one. This one is very well worn. This would be the one that I would want to use when I don't want my pattern lines to be very dark. So I'll see how this works on here. It may not give me dark enough lines. So let's see how it's doing. Oh, plenty dark enough. Plenty dark enough. So I don't even need to push as hard as I thought I was going to need to push. My pencil lines are so light on here. On my leaves anyway, because I wasn't sure when I, as I was drawing this, if I was going to even add the leaves. Now this surface that I'm painting on is available through CD Wood. It's a laser cut out of birch. Okay, that looks really good. Sorry, I'm putting that on. Okay. Now we're going to get ready for some base coats. These pears are a little yellow with some greens on them, you know. So I am going to start my first color, my base color for these pears is going to be moon yellow. So I'm going to get my pears, probably will take two coats of moon yellow, smooth coats. Let me put one coat on here so you can see how I want you to do it. I want smooth coats that are not thick and globby coats. So what I do after I put it on my palette is I dip my brush in water. I've just got a flat brush. And then I laid it on my paper towel to get excess water out. So then I'm just kind of, the water that's left in my brush, I'm just kind of blending it in there in that paint. Now I'm pulling it out and kind of working it into my brush. Now, as I push down, I don't know how well you can see that, but there is a lot of water in that brush still. So I'm going to go lay it on my palette. And you can see when all the excess water comes out of your brush. So just, not my palette, but my paper towel. So just lay it down on your paper towel and you'll see all that excess water come out. And then you can just go load your brush, nice flat brush. And then you just want to come in here with good smooth coats. I'm going to put this up on an easel so you guys can see it a little bit better. Your coats need to be nice and smooth. So if they are getting to where your paint is thick and you're leaving ridges, then you need to add some water to your paint. Because you want nice, smooth coats. And it may mean that you have to put, you know, an extra coat on there to get that look. But if you can have just a little bit of water in with your paint so it's not quite so thick, you will get a nice smooth coat on there. Okay, so let's get our pears painted in with moon yellow. And I think our leaves, we will base them with, I had originally picked avocado, but I think we will base them with Hauser medium green. So let's get those on there and we'll come back and start getting some detail on these. Okay, as I finish up my first base coats, I'm erasing my graphite lines. Now, I just wanted to point out that if you paint over your graphite line, so for instance, on these leaves, you may not be able to see the graphite lines very well. Okay, right here on this pear, I painted over that graphite line. So that graphite line is now set in my paint. So if I don't want to see that graphite line, I need to make sure that I cover it with paint. If you're doing light colors and you don't put a light enough graphite line on there, then you'll end up seeing it through your paint. So you'll just have to learn to be happy with it. That took something that took me a while to realize that those graphite lines, no matter how hard I try to erase them, once you brush over them with paint or any kind of sealer or glazing medium or anything like that, it's set in there. Even if you have, if you've washed your brush out in your dirty water and you put water over it, there's still a little bit of paint in that water, so it will still keep that graphite line set in there. So you want to be aware of that as you paint and erase any graphite lines that, if they're not coming off, you're just going to have to paint over them or really be happy with them in your piece. So I just wanted to give that quick tip. I'm going to get my second coats on so we can start getting detail. All right, let's get busy on some detail on this now. I've got out on my palette right here some olive green. I want to put some green tints onto these yellow pears right here. So I am going to be using these curved flats. That one I need to clean, looks like. They have a 12, a 10, and a 6. They are wonderful brushes for floating. I love them because they create such a soft float. Now if I'm needing to have a little bit tighter or controlled float, I will use just an angle brush, but I most of the time I just use these brushes. So I'm going to start with the number 12, and again you can use a angle brush if you prefer, or if you like to float with a flat brush, then by all means use what you feel comfortable with. I'm going to show you how I load to float. The first thing I do is I take my misting bottle and I spray all along this edge of my palette paper. So I've got all different sizes of water drops on there. Okay, so I will pick up water on this curved edge of my brush right here if I feel like I need water. So this is how I load my brush. You load your brush whatever is comfortable for you. But I like to dip the toe in it, and then I start working it into my brush, and I make just a little V right here by the paint. Now, I don't know how well you can see on the camera there, but I have a lot of water in my brush. So I am just going to go lay it on my paper towel and let the excess water come out of there. Now I'm going to go right back here to loading it. Now I want a pretty good size float on here, so I'm going to push a little harder. I want to get the paint over on my brush and up on the bristles, so I will have enough paint to carry through the large float that I want to do. Now when I float, I use a little bit more water than most people use. I use a mop brush, but if you've got a technique that you like to do that you've is comfortable for you, then you use that technique. But this is how I like to do my floating. Now we're going to work on this pear right here. I'm going to turn this upside down. I think I will zoom you in just a little bit. I don't want to get too tight because sometimes I get off camera when I get too tight there. So I want some greens in this. So I'm just going to start like pulling it out in like a V, bringing it out into that pear a little bit. I'm going to take my mop brush and I'm in the water area. Now I'm just going to barely tap into that paint. I don't want to remove the paint, but I want to soften that a little bit. Okay, I want to put some, I guess I could use my little table that I've got set up here. This is just an artist's easel that rotates and tilts, spins and tilts. Let's see. Let's have a little green over here. I don't really want it in my leaf right there, so I'm going to clean that up with the water edge. So this we will not carry over as far. We don't want it to meet that other. Okay, now to clean your mop brush. All right, before I clean it, right here, there's a little bitty hard line right there. I don't want that hard line, so I'm going to take the water edge of my brush and get that paint damp and work that hard line out of there. I let it dry a little bit too long before I started working it, so I got it. Okay, now to clean your mop brush, you go to a wet place on your paper towel and you get the paint out of your brush. See all that paint that came out of my mop brush? Then you go to a dry place and you dry it off. Okay, then you're good to go. let's move to the next pair. Pick up some more water. A little bit more paint. Okay, now I want to keep the green on this one more up here. So I'm just going to float that around that top edge. Something there in my paint. Maybe come down this side just a little bit. I'm going to mop in the water edge. You don't want to go into your paint unless you have to, because you don't want to remove the float that you just put on there. But if you've got it a little bit heavy, and as long as you've got enough water in there, you can gently soften that. Okay, now I want to have some of this green come down into the center of this, so I'm just going to float a little bit, then I flip my brush over and I float a little bit there. Now this is where I will take my brush and go all the way down that in the paint, because I want to soften that whole thing right there. Okay, I know it looks like, you know, I just painted a streak down the center. Well, that is basically what I did, but we're going to keep working at this and building onto it. Okay, this one that's laying down, I want to put some green down here. Now when you're floating, if you can lay your brush flat, unless you're in a really tight area, and have soft pressure when you're floating, then you will get beautiful, beautiful floats. You will be so surprised. You've got to have the right amount of water and paint in your brush. So play around with floating. It's not as difficult as some people think it is. I know that's one of the most stressful things when you're learning to paint, is figuring out how to float. It really just takes practice, because when I first started painting, I thought, oh my goodness, that floating, whew, I don't know if I can get that. But it comes. It just comes with practice, and you will just be so surprised. Soft pressure, laying your brush flat. That's how you get beautiful, beautiful floats. Okay, I want to put some antique gold on here. I've got golden straw and antique gold here. I might start with golden straw and build the antique gold. I want to keep them yellow, but I don't want them bright yellow like lemons, like they are now. So I'm going to put these two colors on my palette. I'm going to stay with the same brush. I'm going to start with the golden straw, loading it the same way that I previously loaded. Okay, and let's put some of this. Let's see if we can even see it. We may not even be able to see this golden straw. We can see it a little bit. So we might build on that. It is not as dark as I thought it would be. I'm just tapping color in randomly. That color is not popping out as much as I would like it to. But I'm going to keep going with it, because that's what I started with. It will be a good one to build on. That out in like a V. Okay, that didn't give me as much color as I wanted, but it gave me a little bit of color. You can start to see it a little bit now that it's starting to dry. So let's go into the antique gold. Now this color will be quite dark on these pears. So I definitely want to thin this down with some water. So I have a little bit more water in my brush, and I'm not pulling near as much paint out, and I'm really working that water into it to make it a little more watery. Because this color will be pretty dark, and I want it to not take over my pear completely. Water, more paint, but I do want to try and get it in the places where I put that other. We want a nice variation of color on here. Now I'm mopping the whole area that I just painted because I don't want a lot of heavy paint on there. I want to keep these softer. Okay, definitely need more water. Up little water drops. Okay, you're starting to see some of that golden yellow on there now. Let's put a little bit up here where we put that other, that golden straw. Walked it out in a V. And let's put a little bit, I want it down here on this edge. Okay, let's get some cocoa out. And I think I'll put a little bit of burnt umber on my palette. I think burnt umber will be too dark. And cocoa is going to be too light. So we may mix the two. Okay, I'm going to go to a smaller curved flat. You could just go to a flat brush if that's what you would prefer to do. But we're going to start creating some little irregularities in our pears. So I'm going to just brush mix some cocoa and some burnt umber. I want that kind of medium brown there. Okay. And we want to start creating some like little irregular places on these pears, because pears aren't perfect. They have all these dots and dimples, and you can just put these wherever you want on your pears. This pear, the shape of it almost is too much like a lemon there at the top. It needs to be a little more rounded. So I think I will come back with my base color and round that a little bit more. Some little dots and whatever on your pears. It's just a random little thing. There's not very much paint on my brush at all. Now, you could use a round brush and get some of these little dimple places on here with that. I just stay up on the toe of my curved flat, and that way I can just tap on there as if I had a round brush or a, well, basically a round brush. Now this one I want to create a little bit bigger. Place on this, within this pear. Okay, I'm going to take my mop brush and just soften that a little bit. Now these are some of the bigger areas that we're going to be doing on these pears. So I am going to, as soon as I'm done here, I'm going to pick up a small round brush and I'm going to start adding some more little details and dimples and what have you on here. Okay, before I go any further, I am going to fix this pear, the shape of it. It needs a little bit more, so I'm just going to do it with my 10 curve flat. I'm just going to load on the corner some of our base color, which was moon yellow. And I will take, so I don't get too wild with it, take my chalk pencil. And draw that in there. Flatten that top there just a little bit. Okay, I'm going to let that dry, and then I'll come back and add some different color on there. Okay, I'm going to take a number one round brush. This is a Winsor & Newton brush. I love their round brushes because I can use them like a small flat, because when I need paint loaded like on a flat brush, I can just flatten this brush out and it will paint just like a small flat. So I really love their brushes. Okay, I'm going to take a little bit of burnt umber on my palette. I think I'll put some, let's see, I'm going to put some avocado and some Hauser medium green. On there as well. We're going to start just creating some little speckly areas on here. And I like to touch back with my finger a lot. That softens the paint that I'm putting on there and helps it not to be so bright and overbearing. So we're just creating some little bit of darker areas on these. And it's just a tap, dabbing kind of motion. I'm starting out with that brown mix. And then we're going to go into those greens and put those greens mostly in the green areas. Completely random with this. Just let it flow through your hand. Don't try to control the brush. Just be soft and easy. Okay, now we're going to pick up one of those greens. I'm going to go into Hauser medium green first. Put a few little green areas and the green dots. I'm putting this mostly where I put that green paint. Okay, before I go any further, I want to finish this top up here. I'm going to take some antique gold darken that edge up a little bit. Dry. Okay, I want to do just a little bit, not too much, of the avocado. I don't want too much of this because it's very dark. So this will be not sure that you can tell too much of the difference between that and avocado. And now for our final green, let's put some the color that we shaded with, olive green. See too much of this because the floating is this color. Okay. I'm going to go back to my 12 curve flat. I'm going to float a little bit more green on here. I want the pear to be a little bit more green. It's almost like a washy float. I've got a lot of water within my paint down, so I can carry the color a little bit farther, but it's not a dark wash. It's very light, very washy. I'm just picking up a lot of water in my brush. I've got a lot of water. This is very thin, and I'm not controlling it on the tip. It's okay if it goes over farther on my brush. Where you make decisions on how you want your pear to look, where you want maybe more green to be on your pear. You think it needs more green out here in the center? And just grab you some paint, some water, and just walk that in there. I'm going to take my mop brush and mop into that. Just gently. I know when I'm doing my videos, sometimes it looks like I'm just pouncing really hard, but I am giving the lightest of pressure and just barely touching down in that because I don't want to remove all the work that I just put on there. Okay, I want to get a little bit more antique gold. I'm going to mix it with Golden Straw, so I picked up Moon Yellow and Golden Straw, and I'm mixing it, so I want it a little bit lighter than that. I want it to be like in between these two colors. So I think that's like a good medium tone color. Not really sure I'm liking that. Put a little bit more of the Golden Straw in it. I don't want to lose that gold tone that I have on there. And you see I'm going right over my dots, all that speckling that I put on there. Mop. Water there. Brush is getting pretty dry. pear goodness going on here. Alright, I'm going to take my liner brush. I want to come back and add just a couple of really bold, bright brown spots. And this is just straight burnt umber this time. Straight burnt umber. It's just a dab and a wiggle. Okay, let's take some country red. And I want to create just a little glaze of this. It's going to be a very, very light glaze. So it's going to be kind of like I did that yellow just a minute ago, where I've got mostly water. Not very much paint at all, because we can always add more red to this if we want. But once we get it on here, we can't take it off. So I'm just going to put a little bit of wash of red. Oops, that is not my mop brush. And some random areas on these pears. I'm keeping it very washy. Those are looking yummy, yummy, yummy. Okay, I want to start creating a shadow on this one so I can define my pears a little bit more. I'm going to try graphite and see if it's too dark. So I'm going to keep this very thin, just like I did that red, because I don't know if it's going to be too dark. I want to be able to remove it. Okay, so I've got a shadow here. These two have a shadow. Definitely have to make that a little darker. We're going to have a little bit of shadowing down here. I'm just dabbing that in. On there. Okay, I'm going to use this color to create a really deep. This is that graphite. I may have called it charcoal a while ago, but it's graphite. It's the color we put around the outside border here. I'm just using the toe of this brush. I'm trying to create this little area where the stem comes out. I'm trying to keep that really tight. I want it to look deep down in there. Work from this angle. shape that I want. It's a little better. Okay, this one up here, we're not going to see too much of this. We're going to see maybe that edge and that edge. Come back and deepen that. And this one we won't see it at all because the stem is on the back. The pear is like tilted towards the back, so we won't see that one at all. So let me deepen this right here. I think I'll need to go to my 6 curve flat. That one's just a little bit too big. This one may be a little bit too big as well. Okay, you see how that's creating that little area? So now we want to highlight on the other side. So I'm going to start with some of the moon yellow. Excuse me. And I've got warm white here. So I'm going to mix a little bit of moon yellow and warm white on my brush. I just pick both up on my brush and just brush mix them on the toe of that brush. Okay, so I want to create a little highlight right there. Now I'm taking the water edge and taking some of that paint off because I want that float to stay pretty tight. Okay, now I want to put some green around this one. Go back into that olive green. So I want this one to be more green around it. That's okay that I'm covering up that red. So now I'm just kind of walking it out, just tap walking. Okay, I think I might glaze over this with some green. That white is just a little bit bright. We'll save that for our brightest highlights. All right, let's go and intensify the shading with that graphite. A little bit darker. Okay, I think we've got it good next to that pear, but we're going to want to walk it out a little bit more, create a little bit more depth in that shadow. And this one I'm just making a little V, not real big. Okay, let's start working on the highlight. I'm going to do the moon yellow and warm white mixed on my brush. I just dipped into each one and just mixed it right on my brush. Okay, so our light is coming from the left and going across. So I want to start creating our brightest highlights right here. So I am just tapping in a little highlight there. Soften that. And then it's going to come down the pear like this. Okay, this is just that moon yellow and warm white mixed together. Equal amounts. Okay, we're going to have this one's going to be pretty bright right through here. I'm just tapping it in, down, and then flipping my brush over so that they are back to back with the paint. And now I'm just barely mopping that to lighten that, soften that highlight. Okay, now this one's the highlight's going to be right across here. So I'm just tapping that highlight in. It's just a tapping motion. Then I'm going to go tap on the other side of that, what I just put on there. And now I'm going to softly blend them. Okay, so there's our first highlight on there. Now, before I go any further, I want to create a little bit more shadow on this one. So this whole bottom of this pear will be in the shadow. So let's start building that out there. And this is going to come out a little bit more here. See, I'm just tapping that paint on there. This to be a little bit darker here. I think I'm going to put just a little bit on this side. Not too much. Okay, they're looking like pretty delicious pears. Alright, let's go in with some more highlight. I think before I do any more highlighting, I think I'm going to add a little bit more speckling. I'm going to take that red and thin it down pretty good. And in the areas where I put some red, I think I'm going to add a little bit of some red speckles in there. Let's see, I think I covered my red up on this one, so let me put just a little bit up here. Just a little bit. Then I can add some little speckles in there. Make a couple just a little brighter. I won't see that too much after I float. Let's see, where were I? A little bit more of the shading. That's what we're working on. I want to put a little bit more down here. Just a little bit. Get some more water on my brush. I think that shadow is looking pretty good, but I need to maybe redefine this edge over here. So I'm going to go into the green. Just float a little bit of that along there. This edge over here needs a little bit as well. Stay with this green for a minute, and all my green areas I think I will just touch up a little bit. Cover up my red I got there. Let's go and intensify some more on our highlight. I'm going to take some more of that moon yellow and warm white and mix it together. We're going to do one more layer of this mix, and then we're going to go straight white, warm white. So I'm just putting that on there and then softening it. I'm going directly into all the paint that I'm putting on there. I'm not just staying in the water edge because I want the whole highlight to be softened. Okay, this highlight, I think I want to widen it just a little bit. A bigger area that is. A little brighter there. Okay, I'm going to take my number one round, and these areas right here, I'm just going to line that and walk it out just a little bit. I really want these areas to be a little bit darker. Okay, now I just touch it back with my finger there. Those pears are looking pretty good. Okay, let's go ahead and create our stem. We are going to start with cocoa on our stems. We still got some, you know, highlighting and stuff to do on our pears yet, but I want to get our stems in there. These stems are pretty fat. You can create them, you know, whatever shape you like, or you can just use the pattern. That one almost looks too fat, so I am going to remove some of it. I'm just using a wet brush and removing some of that paint. That looks a little better. Okay, and then this one here, just it goes back behind. It's on the back side because this pear is turned. So we'll just create it like that. Okay, now I'm just going to wipe my brush. No need to clean it. I'm going to go into burnt umber. And I want to put some of this along the tip of these stems. Not being very, let me zoom in just a little bit more. I'm not being very careful about it. I'm just kind of dragging it on there. Okay. Now I want to go into some green. I'm going to go into avocado. We want to pull some green from the pear up. Way too much paint on my brush, so I just went and wiped all the paint out. And I'm just taking what I've got there, pulling it up. It's just kind of a dragging, almost a dry brush kind of thing. This one is too perfect up here, so I'm going to have to work on that one. Okay, let's take just a little bit of the yellow, the moon yellow. We're just going to kind of streak that in here, create a little highlight on these. Okay, now I want a little bit of, well, let's try graphite. I was going to go with lamp black, but since we've already got graphite on our palette, we'll just try it. I want some of this to come into the brown areas. Just dragging, pulling, streaking it in there. Okay. Now I want to float at the base of every one of these with graphite. Touch up around this one with my gray sky. I kind of smeared that background a little bit. So I'm just using my 6-curve flat. Okay, I'm going to, I'm not really liking the shape of this one, so I'm going to come into it a little bit and make it a little more irregular. It's just a little bit too perfect. I don't want the perfect look here. Okay, I'm going to take a little bit of more of antique gold. And I might mix just a tiny bit of that red with it. Teeny tiny bit of red. Tiny bit. I need to create this a little bit darker up here. Okay, those pears are looking yummy, aren't they? Okay, let's see. Where do we want to go from here? Let's intensify that highlight a little bit. This time we're just going to use straight warm white. We're not going to thin it down. And we're just going to keep this a little bit tighter. Now, as you build highlights, each layer that you put on should get smaller and smaller and smaller so that your eye is drawn right into that highlight. So now I'm keeping this more in the center of all those highlights that I put on there. With a mop brush. Okay, I'm going to do this shading one more time. I think I'm going to add a little bit of burnt umber to it this time. Maybe that will help that just a little bit. So I just brush mix equal amounts of graphite and burnt umber. Are looking pretty good. Okay. Before we create the shadow underneath these pears, I'm going to go ahead and do the leaves. I took a picture so I could look at this to see, because something about the highlights weren't quite right. So I know what it is now. They are not wide enough on the first layer. So I'm brush mixing that moon yellow and warm white, and I am just going to bring that out. I know it looked like I put like a ton of paint on there, but trust me, there was hardly any paint in my brush, mostly water. I just want to bring that out wider. It is not coming out far enough. I don't want to bring it too far down here because then it will be in my shadow. I think I'm going to have to do that one more time. Not quite. I've got too much water now on my brush. I know that seems impossible, but I do. Okay. Now I am pushing a little bit harder when I mop that because I want to really soften that out there. Okay, now I'm going to go straight, warm white, go down to a smaller brush, go down to my 10, number 10 curve flat. I'm just loading it on the toe. So now I'm going to create some bullseye highlights on here. A bullseye is just where you lay the brush down and walk it around in a circle, keeping the paint in the middle and the water on the outer edge. And then you quickly mop it to soften it. So let me show you how one's done here. So I've got my paint on the toe. A little bit more. I'm just keeping the paint touching the whole time, creating like a little circle. And then I just mop pretty much the whole thing to soften it. So I want to create a couple of those on this one. Creating a little circle and mop it. I'm going to have to come back in on my browns and brighten them back up. I really washed them out when I was putting this highlight on here. Okay, I'm going to keep that highlight on that one just right there. This one. More paint. And that keeps that really bright highlight concentrated right there where you want it. Do a little one there. I'm going to do one more on this one because this one has more of the light reflecting on it. Soften it. Right, let me come back in and add a few more of my darker brown areas. So one round, I'm going to use straight burnt umber. Some more of my greens in there. Okay, this one needs more red. A little bit. Now remember, red is a very, this country red's a very bright color. So we want to not let it take over. So you want to keep this nice soft wash. This down here. A little bit more up here. I just walk that down into like a V when I'm walking it out. Alright, I'm going to take another picture of this and come back and see what I think. Okay, I'm pretty happy with those pears right now. So we're going to work on the leaves. So I've got some black green. We're going to need black green and some fresh olive green. Now, I'm going to decide if I want any turn places on my leaves here. I generally always make one or two places that are turned. So I think I will make this edge a little turned edge right there. Okay, and maybe on this one as well. Okay, and you could have, you know, more than one, like on this one. I could come in here and like turn this edge here as well. So both edges are curved up. So since I've already drawn that on there, we'll just go ahead and go with that. Okay, we're going to start with black green. Let's see, I think I'll go with my 10 curved flat so I don't get too wide of a float at first. Load it like I showed you at the beginning. Okay, so all these little curved places that I have created here, we want it to be darker underneath there, so I'm just going to float, soft pressure, laying my brush flat, you know, where I can. If I've got some tight areas, then I will definitely make that a little tighter. It'll be up on the toe, I guess. Very easy to make your turned areas. Now, I think on this leaf here, I'm going to create a little like tear in this leaf. Okay, so I'm going to take my gray sky and fill in that area right there, because that is our background area. We are going to create a little tear in that particular leaf. Okay, so we're going to float. Get some more water on my palette here. This other curved one here. And I've got my curves a little irregular instead of being a perfect little turned leaf. Now I want to come in and float at the base of these flowers, or leaves, excuse me. Just deepen that, soften it with a mop brush. probably might create a little bit of shading right there. So I'm going to take some avocado and very, very lightly create just a little shadow right there. Oops. Soften that out. Alright, back into the black green. Let's do the base of this one. Moved a little bit of my paint because I went into my float right there, so I will have to redo that. Okay, I have my paint way over on my brush, so let's do this one down here. Just walking that up a little bit. Okay, I want to get my six curved flat out because I want to float on the outside edges of these turned places. So keep this from coming up too far on the leaf. Since I've got this six curve flat, I'm going to go around this little tear in the leaf right here with this black green. I'm just going to go float all the way around it, just kind of tapping it, making it look irregular. We don't want our tear to be perfect. Okay. Now I'm going to pick up a little bit of red. Brush mix it right there with that green that's on there. And I want to put a little bit of this on there. You can also put some burnt umber on there if you wanted. Okay, I just want that tear to be a little bit more defined. Alright, back to my number 10 and my black green. I want to float again the back of all these. Walk it out. Gently, gently mop to soften it. Have to go underneath the turned areas again, and I will use the number 6 curved flat for that. You would use a small angle, 1/8 or 1/4 inch, to get tight under there, which I could use an angle brush as well, but I just have gotten so used to using the curved flats that I just prefer to use them. So let me do that real quick. Get underneath the turned leaves one more time, just like in the darkest, the most turned places. Okay. So each one of these where it's got a little indent, we'll get the darkest of the green, the black green. I want to create some veining down the center of these. So let's start with this one here. I'm just going to float down the center. Okay, I'm just softening it with my finger. And going to go and do all of these on one side. I definitely need more water. You see how I'm having to work that float to pull it out? I need more water on my brush. Okay, this one here. Softening back with my finger. Let's create the other side of this vein. So I leave just a little gap in the center there. I took a really good leaf class from Donna Hodson. She is on TPU. I do not paint leaves near as good as she does. She is amazing. But she taught me a lot about painting leaves. I still can't make mine look quite as realistic as she does. But her technique is one that I have used over and over again. Let's add some highlights on our turn places. We're going to go into olive green. Okay, now we want to stay tight on these areas that are real narrow. Stay up on your toe, and then you can kind of walk it down into those other areas. I really am not sure. I can't remember what the veining is on pear leaves. But I do know they're generally pretty fat and they come up kind of pointy at the very end. So these technically are not perfect little shaped leaves for pears, but I think they'll do. Shade on this one that I just did a little bit. Right here, I brought my highlight just a little bit too far over. Okay, now we want to put a little bit of highlighting on the tips of the ones. This one we won't because it's folded in. But we'll put a little bit on the tips. I think we will repeat that to intensify it a little bit. I think we'll come back and repeat the highlight on the turned areas as well. I think I'll just keep it on that side of that one. I don't think I put a first highlight on this one. This will be the first one on this one. Okay, getting a little carried away with my paint on this one, so I'm going to have to probably come back and touch the background up around that. But that's okay. That's the good thing about having a solid background. Very, very easy to clean it up. Okay, this one in particular, I want to intensify on this. I'm going to go back with my black green one more time on these turned edges because I think I've lost a little bit of the depth here. Okay, now we want to create some veining in these leaves. So I'm going to use a 10-0 liner. You can use whatever liner brush that you prefer to use. And I'm going to use my black green. So we're just going to thin that black green down with some water. So I dipped into my water, I went into my paint, pulled some out, and now I'm mixing it with water because I need it to be the consistency of ink. Okay, now I'm going to go wash my brush and wipe the water, wipe it off on my paper towel. I want all the excess paint and all the excess water out of my brush. So now I'm just going to load my brush into this paint right here that I just created a nice inky flow of. I like to roll my brush and pull it out and get a nice tip. So you can choose to do however. Let me go in on this big one here. I try to remember to zoom you back out as I do leaves because I tend to get out of focus, as I've said. So now I'm just going to create all these scraggly little lines within this leaf. All these little veins. Bring some up around on the edges here if you want. You won't see too much of that. Okay, so we're going to do that to all the leaves. Let me back you back out now so I don't forget. Soften that, especially where it's in the brightest areas. We don't want our veins to be so noticeable. It's like little branches on trees. You're just creating tree branches in those leaves. Very thin. Stay up on your toe. Your paint really has to be thin. Consistency of ink to keep these soft and just flowing off your brush. You have got to keep that paint thin and stay up on the toe of your brush. Okay, now we want to connect these leaves. So we're going to go into the, we're still using our 10-0 liner. We're going to go into the olive green. Forgot what I was using there for a minute. And I think I will get some Hauser medium green out. So this is not too awful bright. And just brush mix those two. Remember, you have to thin them the consistency of ink. So I just pulled a little bit out of each color and mixed it. So we want to connect these. We want to go down the center. Okay, we're going to darken the leaf stems just a little bit. We're going to have this one coming around. Okay, now I'm going to go into some black green, just dirty brushing right there on that. We're going to pull some of this black green up onto each one of these. Keep your paint. Consistency of ink so that you can okay. Now I see I need to darken where these stems, the base of these stems. So I'm going to go into that black green and use it. Each one of these. Just want to darken them up a little bit. Okay, let me zoom out just a little bit. We've got the shadow to put underneath these pears yet. So I'm going to take a large flat brush. I've got a half inch. You don't have to go quite that big if you don't want to. I'm going to get some fresh graphite out. Now, you don't have to do this. You can leave your pears just like this without creating any shadow underneath them. This is not a still life. It's just painted pears. So, completely up to you. So, I'm side loading into graphite. Okay, now we want to create the shadow underneath these pears. So my paint is kind of thin. I just want some shadowing underneath these, just a little bit under here. Mop brush so I can soften. Okay, a little bit more into this one. Okay, we're just creating a little bit of shadowing. So I need to dry this, so I'm going to use my little less than $2 fan at Walmart with the batteries already in it. To intensify that, especially in some of these darker areas, like up in here. I don't want to lose the shape of my pear there. So I just took the water edge and just kind of softened that. Took some of the paint off. I'm going to get it darker up in here, actually up on that pear a little bit. That's really choppy around that. Boy, that's a terrible job there. So let me fix that. Need more water. Get the shape of my pear back right here. I really chopped that up, didn't I? Have to go float back on that pear and get that shape back up there a little bit better. Okay, I need that darker underneath that pear and right back in there. It needs to be darker. So I'm going to put more paint on my brush. Okay. I'm going to use the toe of the brush and push, push some of that paint up in there. Okay. Now I'm just going to soften that with a mop brush. We've got a little bit of hard line there, so let me soften that. A little bit here. Shadow just needs to be up on that pear a little bit more. Now let me see if I can. I'm going to have to turn this upside down so that I can pull towards me and get a little bit more underneath this pear. Okay, I'm off that. Okay. Let me take a little bit of antique gold. I'm going to have to fix the shape of that one pear there. I'm just going to stay with this flat brush. I need to fix this one. There we go. Much better. Okay, I don't need help out on this one. Still not quite the shape that I want. Just antique gold, just reshaping these just a little bit. Still not happy with this one here. Still not happy. Okay, let me get a little bit of green. I don't want to lose my greens. This is where you just go in and touch up and redefine, you know, the different areas that you feel need redefined. Looking pretty good. Still got a little bit of green in my brush here. Just working that in here and there. Okay, I think this is pretty close to done. I'm going to leave you for a moment and go take a picture so that I can look at it and see any areas that need to be adjusted, and then we'll come back and do the finishing touches on this. Okay, I did go back and deepen my shading here a little bit and brought some of the shadow onto the pear right there from that pair. Now I want to shade the next to my border here. I think this will probably be the last thing that we do. So I'm going to dampen that with a damp brush. Then I have side-loaded graphite, a nice thin side load. I'm going to paint it, laying my brush flat. Let me mop that, soften it a little bit. Just float this all the way around. Make sure I get the right brush. I'm going to dampen this. I have my ceiling fan on above me, so I might need just a little bit more water than normal. It's drying very quickly. I don't want this paint over really far on my brush. I want to keep this just a soft float next to this. When I'm squeezing there, as I go pick up paint, there's water on my palette. And I don't want to have so much water on my brush, because I pre-wet this. So, let me mop this. In the paint, because it's a little more irregular than I like. Okay, I'm not sure if I'm going to do this more than once. I'm going to do it one time and see how I like it. Laying my brush flat, soft pressure. Switch from end to end so I give those areas a chance to dry before I move on. I'm going to do this area here. Try to get the paint on there before the ceiling fan dries all the water that I put on there. This really long section here. So I'm going to pre-wet it. I'll go ahead and get my brush loaded here. Okay, finish pre-wetting this. Now this is graphite that I'm floating with, so it's the same color that we painted our border with, so if I get over on my border, it's not a big deal. More paint. I think I've got too much water on this top edge here. In the paint, so I make sure that I, okay, this is a smaller section here, so I'm going to float it without pre-wetting it. I really only needed to pre-wet those longer areas. One section left here to do. I'm going to make sure that one is dry because I don't want to cut through that float because I will remove it see. Zoom out just a little bit so we can take a good look at this and see if you like that shading on there or if I need to deepen it. And I think I'm going to go one more time with it. I think it needs a little bit of deepening, so I'm going to work on these sections here. So I'm going to do this one, then this one, this one, then this one, this one, then this one. And then I will do the edges. So one more time. This is still a pretty washy float in the water area. I'm going to come do this one. I just want it to be a little bit darker. Now you could use your angle brush as well. I just chose to use this flat brush because it would give me just a little bit wider float, and that's what I wanted. Side. I'm really trying to clean my mop brush with each float that I do on this one because I have so much water that I'm using. Wow, don't have near enough water for that float. That I want to make sure that my mop brush doesn't get clogged up with a lot of paint. Okay, I've got the ends of it now. So now I want to do the longer areas. So let me load my brush. Squeeze out the excess water on that water edge and pre-wet this. Pick up some more paint. Okay, now I'm going to do some serious mopping here. Water edge. Just rub that on my hand to remove the excess water on it. Now I'm just going to come back and gently, very gently and very light pressure tap in that paint section so I can smooth that a little bit. All right, one more side here. The water edge. I'm going to remove that excess water on my hand. Go back in and tap on the paint very softly. Okay, what do we think about that? I think that's looking pretty good. Okay, I think we're going to call this project a completed project. Now you've got the back that you can paint something completely different on. feet are done. You could always change the feet if this color does not go with something you paint on the other side. You could paint them black and they would go with either side then. So thank you so much for painting this with me. I hope that you enjoyed it, and send me pictures on Facebook or in an email. Let me know how well you've done on your pears.